I'm Andrew Jones. I'm the chair of the Center for Chinese Studies here at the University of California at Berkeley.
我是安卓琼斯，我是加大伯克利分校的东亚语言文化教授。
It's a real pleasure to see you all here at the beginning of what promises to be an exciting program of discussion of the role of art and culture in Sino-American relations.
今天非常荣幸的在这里跟大家一起开始这个我相信会是非常有成效的中美之间关于文化和艺术在我们两国之间的关系的角色的这样一个讨论。
I'm also gratified that this conference will take place here at a university and in a region that has been, from the 19th century onwards, a fulcrum for Chinese-American exchange.
我也很高兴这次的活动能够在加大伯克莱举行, 因为我们伯克莱学校是在从19世纪以来一直是中美文化交流的一个中心。
Berkeley was one of the very first American universities to establish a chair in Chinese in the year 1872. When the population of California was 90,000, less than the population of Berkeley, the city, today.
Berkeley是第一个在建立一个中国学习的这样一个机构，当时是1872年，加州的人口才19,000多，还不到就是今天这个学校的人数。
The year Chinese started being taught here, Berkeley was not yet a city, in fact. And the university only graduated 12 students.
当时开始这个中国学习的时候呢，当时这个学校还没有，这个伯克利还没有成为一个城市，当时只有12名学生。
These connections, of course, go much deeper than just teaching Chinese, of course. The historical core, for instance, of the collection in the CV Star East Asian Library, which was just constructed 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I believe, actually belonged to a man named John Fryer. John Fryer was known in Chinese as Fu Lan Ya, and he's one of the crucial figures in the introduction of modern science into China in his role as the head translator at the Jiangnan Arsenal in Shanghai.
当然这个中文学习并不是说我们这个中美文化的唯一的一个项目，我们之间的这个关系呢，还有之前更悠久的历史，比如说这之前三年呢，有一个这个中文学习的这么一个图书馆，当时这个跟这图书馆有关的呢，是一位叫做John Fryers 的这名先生，他介绍了。
He played a crucial role in translating modern science into Chinese as one of the translators at the Jiangnan Zhizaozhu, the Jiangnan Arsenal in Shanghai in the 19th century.
他将这个现代的科学翻成中文，是在当时江南制造局一个翻译之一。
Over the years, Berkeley has also played host to and actually become home to many luminaries in modern Chinese arts, literature, and culture.
这些多年以来呢，伯克莱成为这个中国文化学习的一个可以说是一个基地。
So including figures as famous as the great May 4th intellectual and linguist Zhao Yuanren,
很多的这个关很多学习中文的中国文化的一些名人，包括五四学习的赵元任，as
well as the writer Zhang Ailing,
还有写作家张爱玲，as
and contemporary writers such as 北岛 and 余华,
还有这个现代的作家，比如说北岛和云华。
And Berkeley continues to be a vibrant center for research and teaching in Chinese studies.
今天呢，伯克利仍然是在这个中文研究和学习方面一个非常有名的一个地方。
Outside the university, this region, the Bay Area and Northern California, was built in part by Chinese immigrants from the gold rush to the Silicon Rush of more recent times.
那么从这个伯克利在向外展示呢，加州这个湾区和整个加州都可以是说它的建设都是跟中国的移民有关的，从当年的淘金到今年到当今的这个硅谷的现代的淘金。
And the culture and the writing and the architecture of Northern California are indelibly inflected by Chinese culture and Asian culture.
这个加州的文化和建筑都跟这个中国的文化有密切的相关。
Actually, the very building we're in today, the faculty club, is an example of that influence of Asian culture on our own architecture here.
就连今天我们所在的这个楼叫 faculty club, 也是很显示出中国文化的影响。
So, I want to thank everyone at the National Endowment of the Humanities, the Ministry of Culture, as well as the Center for Chinese Studies, especially our staff, for arranging such a beautiful conjunction of occasion and place.
我衷心地感谢国家人文基金会，加州伯克莱大学的中文研究中心，安排了这样今天这样一个非常有意义的盛会。
And now I'd like to introduce James Leach, the chair of the National Endowment of the Humanities.
现在呢，我来介绍一下国家人文基金会主席 James Leach 先生。
James Leach is the ninth chairman of the National Endowment for the Humanities, nominated by President Obama in July 2009.
Leach 先生呢是国家人文基金会的第九届主席，是由奥巴马总统2009年7月9号任命的。Chair
Leach previously served for 30 years as a congressional representative for Southeast Iowa.
Leach 先生呢之前的30年是在爱荷华的南东南。
And he chaired committees on banking and financial services, more relevant to our meeting today, on Asian and Pacific affairs, as well as serving in the Executive Commission on China.
他也是银行和金融服务委员会的主席，跟今天更有关的呢，是他是亚太事务委员会的主席，以及这个中国事务的执行主席。He's
taught on the faculty of Princeton's Woodrow Wilson School, and Princeton is also his alma mater.
他在普林斯顿大学的乌德沃森学校曾经就职，普林斯顿大学也是他的母校。He's
also taught at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government.
他也在哈佛大学的肯尼迪政府学院做过教授。
He holds many, many honorary degrees and has been honored for his public service with too many awards to enumerate here. So without any further ado, I'll turn over the floor to Chair Leach. Thank you very much for coming.
他有很多的荣誉学位，我今天就不一一介绍了。Thank you.
Minister Wang, Consul General Gao, and our good friend, Minister Consular Lee from Washington. We welcome you all.
王部长，文化部王部长，还有我们的这个高领事，还有我们从华盛顿过来的一些好朋友哈，首先欢迎各位。
And we're particularly honored to be at this great American University, Berkeley, and thank you, Professor Jones.
那么另外呢，我们也非常荣幸哈，我们能够在这个美国最享有盛誉的伯克利大学举办这个盛会，谢谢您。
In the 19th century, we had a great American poet named Walt Whitman.
那么在19世纪的时候呢，我们有一位非常优秀的美国的诗人叫做Walt Whitman.
And he once suggested that he had a great dream, and the dream was that all of the poets of the world and all of the poems of the world would come together, and that that would serve as a greater group of individuals and of a body of work to bring peace to the world.
那么他呢曾经提到过呢，他曾经呢做过一个非常这个伟大的梦想哈，他希望呢有一天呢能够有全世界的一些诗人，还有那些诗歌呢，我们大家都有机会呢聚集在一起。那这样的话呢，可以把每个人的一些作品以及他们的个人呢都带在一起，然后呢能够呢希望能够给世界呢带来和平。
2.5 millennia earlier, Confucius wrote that if peoples of the earth would spend more time appreciating music and understanding courtesy, there would be no war.
那么在差不多两个世纪以前呢，这个孔子呢曾经这样说过哈，如果人地球上的所有的人呢，能够把多一点的时间去欣赏这个音乐，还有呢相信彼此之间这些礼貌和礼仪的话呢，那么sorry, I got last sentence.
There would be no more war.
那就不会，世界上就不会有战争了。
Yesterday, I had the honor to interview Mo Yan of this wonderful delegation.
那么昨天呢，我有幸呢跟这个代表团一位很好的成员摩阳呢跟他交谈了一次。
And I asked him if he thought greater understanding in the world would come from politicians and assertions of political doctrine, or from novelists and their writings about culture.
那么我问他哈，那么他对这个世界的理解呢，是通过这些政治家以及政治家他们的这些言论呢，还是通过这个阅读了很多小说家的这些作品而来的？
And he took this as an obvious, not difficult question. Of course, he said it will come from those who understand culture.
那么他
from the great literary works of the world.
那么他当然认为这个是一个很容易回答的问题。当然，对世界理解应该是从这些他们对世界比较了解的、深刻的这些作家他们的作品当中的了。
Well, to many so-called realists, this may sound very unrealistic and very naive.
那么对一些所谓的现实主义的人来说呢，他们可能会觉得这个不太现实，而且呢，有点好像太小孩子气的那种想法了。
But 4 or 5 years ago, I happened to be in Beijing shortly after President Hu took office, and the embassy set up a meeting between President Hu and myself.
那么差不多4-5年以前呢，我正好在北京。那个时候呢，刚刚是那个胡锦涛主席任职不久。那么这个大使馆呢，帮我安排了跟那个胡锦涛的一个见面会谈。
At the end of the meeting, I said to President Hu, I was going to see person in the government of higher rank than he was.
那么在会议结束的时候呢，我跟胡先生说呢，我要见一位这个政府机构里面比他还要级别高的一个人。
And he looked at me somewhat quizzically and said, by chance, who would that be?
那他看上去呢，有点好像不知道我在说什么哈，然后说，哎，那这个人是谁呢？
And I explained I was going to visit the Minister of Culture.
那我跟他说呢，我会去拜访文化部的那个部长。
And I said, culture is much bigger than government or politics. Government is part of culture, not the other way around.
我说呢，这个文化呢，比这个政府和政治呢大得多了，而不是呢反过来。
And he laughed and suspected that that might be the case.
那么他也笑了，他是可能也是认为是这样的。
In any regard, it is in the spirit of the importance of culture and cultural understanding that we welcome all of you to this great conference.
那么我们在这种这样尊重文化以及大家都富有这种文化精神的这个气氛下呢，我们欢迎各位来参加我们今天的这个盛会。
And it is my honor to introduce a representative of culture, a very distinguished gentleman, the Deputy Minister of Culture, Mr. Wang. And I will not imply to President Hu that he is of higher rank, but Minister, we are very, very honored that you've joined us at this particular meeting. Mr. Wang.
我现在很荣幸哈，就是呢，请我们这位代表这个文化部的一位文化部副部长，是一位很杰出的副部长啊，王部长。那么我不会再去跟胡先生提说他的这个级别呢比那个他高。那么我在这里呢，就是说欢迎这个王部长上来讲话。
尊敬的美国国家人文基金会主席吉姆·利奇先生，尊敬的美国总统艺术人文委员会执行主任瑞秋·戈斯林斯女士， 加州大学伯克利分校教授安德鲁·琼斯先生，高展生总领事，大家上午好。
Respected Chairman James Leach of the NH, Executive Director Rachel Goslins of the PCAH, Professor Andrew Jones of UC Berkeley, Consul General Gao Zhansheng, ladies and gentlemen, good morning.
今天由中华人民共和国文化部和美国国家人文基金会共同主办，以跨文化双边对话为主题的第二届中美文化论坛，在美国加利福尼亚大学伯克利分校隆重举行。在此，我谨代表中华人民共和国文化部对论坛的开幕表示衷心的祝贺，对出席论坛的中美专家学者表示热烈的欢迎。
Today, I am privileged to witness the opening of the second U.S.-China Cultural Forum at UC Berkeley. The forum, sponsored by the Ministry of Culture of the People's Republic of China, or MOC, and the National Endowment for the Humanities of the United States, or NEH, focuses on the theme of binational conversation on bridging cultures this year. On behalf of the MOC of China, I would like to take this opportunity to extend my heartfelt congratulations to the opening of the forum and my warmest welcome to the participating scholars from both countries.
中美两国虽然远隔千山万水，但以文字见证的中美之间的文化交流已经有190多年的历史。当然，中美之间开始频繁的文化交流还是从近现代开始。1979年1月，中美正式建交，联合签署了《中美文化交流协定》，开创了中美文化交流与合作的新纪元。中国独特绚丽的文化艺术更多的被美国人民所了解。处在改革开放新的发展时期的今天的中国，开始以开阔的胸襟和眼光吸收世界优秀文化，包括美国电影等在内的多种文化产品进入中国民众的视野。美国的现当代文化艺术也为中国的学者和艺术家所熟悉和借鉴。可见，中美文化交流正处在一个迈向不断升华的一个新的时期。它不但沟通两国人民的心灵与情感，增进理解和信任，还对维持中美两国关系健康稳定的发展起到重要的作用。两国人民在文化上的这种越来越近的相互交往，使我们想到了美国学者托马斯·弗里德曼先生在他的《21世纪简史》中所说的：“我们现在生存的世界是平的。”
Geographically, the U.S. and China are two widely apart countries. However, our two countries have had a recorded history of cultural exchanges for over 190 years. The cultural exchange between China and the U.S. has seen an upsurge in modern history, especially after the diplomatic relations were established and the cultural agreement was signed in January 1979. All of this ushered in a new era of the China and U.S. cultural exchanges and cooperations, and thus more of the unique and exquisite Chinese culture and arts came to be introduced to the American public. Being a new development era of reform and opening up, today's China commences to draw on the fine achievements of foreign cultures with a broad mind and perspective. Various cultural products, including American movies, have entered the field of vision of the Chinese public. Chinese scholars and artists are familiar with and draw on the modern and contemporary American culture and arts. By this token, the cultural exchange between our two countries is stepping up to a historic era of sublimation. It not only helps connect the souls and hearts, promotes the understanding and trust between our two peoples, but also plays a vital part in maintaining a sound and stable relationship between our two countries. This ever closer cultural ties remind us of the American journalist and author Thomas Friedman and his remarks in his book, A Brief History of the 21st Century. the world is flat.
2008年12月，由中华人民共和国文化部与美国国家人文基金会共同主办，中国艺术研究院承办，第一届中美文化论坛在北京成功的召开。论坛围绕数字化时代的文化遗产保护和发展这一论题，针对数字技术在文化遗产保护中的作用、数字技术与当代文化发展等多个论题进行了广泛而深入的探讨。这是中美两国主流文化机构进行的第一次学术合作，成为两国在文化领域进行高端学术对话的起点。中美两国就此在文化艺术领域建起一个具有公共性、开放性、互动性的交流平台。
Sponsored by the MOC and the NEH and hosted by China National Academy of the Arts, the first China-US Cultural Forum was held successfully in Beijing in December 2008, focusing on the topic, the protection and presentation of cultural heritage in digital age. Extensive dialogues and profound discussions were conducted in respect of, among others, the role of digital technology in cultural heritage protection, the relationship between digital technology and contemporary cultural development. This was the first academic cooperation between the major cultural institutions of our two countries, forging a starting point of high-level academic conversation. A public, open, and interactive communication platform was created between the Chinese and American cultural sectors.
2009年11月，中国国家主席胡锦涛与美国总统奥巴马在北京举行会谈，发表了中美联合声明，其中强调人文交流对促进更加紧密的中美关系具有重要的意义，并提出建立新的双边机制，召开第二届中美文化论坛，以其全方位推进中美两国文化领域的高端合作与交流。2010年5月，美国国务院、中国国务委员刘延东和美国国务卿希拉里·克林顿联合主持了中美人文交流高层磋商机制成立仪式及第一次会议。再次强调办好第二届中美文化论坛，凸显了两国领导人对此论坛和两国文化领域深层交流的重视。
In November 2009, Chinese President Hu Jintao and the visiting U.S. President Barack Obama held talks in Beijing and issued Sino-U.S. joint statement, which emphasized the importance of people-to-people exchange to further bilateral ties. According to the statement, a new bilateral mechanism was to be established to convene the second U.S.-China Cultural Forum in order to promote the high-level cooperation and exchange in the cultural sectors of our two countries in an all-directional manner. In May 2010, Madame Liu Yandong, State Council of China, and Mrs. Hillary Clinton, U.S. Secretary of State, co-chaired the inauguration ceremony of China-U.S. high-level people-to-people consultation mechanism. Both sides stressed again the wish to a successful second U.S.-China Cultural Forum, displaying the importance attached by the state leaders to the forum and profound exchange of the cultural sectors of the two countries.
在这种背景下举行第二届中美文化论坛，具有独特的时代意义，标志着中美两国文化交流和合作正在不断深化。此次论坛以跨文化双边对话为主题，旨在从文化艺术的各个领域全面回顾中美交流的历史，探讨两国文化交流的现实路径，展望中美文化关系发展的未来，通过多途径文化交流，增进中美两国在社会文化和科学技术领域中的交流与合作，从而推动文化的多样性的协调发展，开辟中美文化交流与合作的新的境界。
The second U.S.-China Cultural Forum held in this particular historical context contains a unique significance and marks the deepening of China-U.S. cultural exchange and cooperation. The theme of this year's forum is a binational conversation on bridging cultures. The discussions will be aimed at a comprehensive review on history of the bilateral exchange with the points of view of the culture and arts field, the realistic approaches and future prospects of the bilateral cultural exchanges will be discussed. The cultural exchange through various channels will enhance the communication and cooperation in the fields of social culture and science and technology, so as to promote the diversified and harmonious cultural development and attain a brand new realm for China-U.S. cultural exchanges and cooperation.
参加今天论坛的中国艺术家和学者都是以自己的艺术创造和学术研究成果在文化艺术领域做出重要社会贡献的杰出人士。他们许多人曾多次到访美国，这次以对话形式所展开的学术交流将具有一种继往开来的意义。中国古代的哲学家曾子曾说：“君子以文会友，以友服人。” 当代中国注重经济、政治、社会、文化、生态协调发展，文化建设摆在中国现代化发展的重要位置。The
participating Chinese artists and scholars who are present today are all outstanding figures who have made remarkable contributions in the culture and arts fields with their art creations and academic achievements. Many of them have visited the U.S. more than once. This year, the academic exchange in the vehicle of conversations will prove to be groundbreaking. Chinese ancient philosopher Zeng Zi once said, "A gentleman makes friends through his learning and cultivates virtue through those friends." Contemporary China lays emphasis on the balanced development of economy, politics, society, culture, and ecology, with cultural development occupying an important place in the modernization.
当代中国文化艺术和学术百花齐放，百家争鸣的局面正在形成。我们正在努力进行当代文化创新，弘扬民族优秀文化的同时，也学习和借鉴包括美国在内的世界各国的优秀文化。因为只有坚持自身文化的独立性，维护人类文化的多样性，坚持开放包容，才有文化发展。 才有文明进步。站在21世纪的地平线上，回顾中美文化交流的历史，我们将以积极务实的态度，展望更加美好的未来。中国有句老话：“万物并育而不相害，道并行而不相悖。”不同文化的交流会使我们学习对方而更具创造性，因为这个文化呢。 它交流呢，才能够使文化更加丰富、更加多彩。我相信，在双方共同努力下，中美两国的文化合作必将迈上一个新的台阶。中美两国文化机构加强交流与合作，符合两国和两国人民的根本利益，有助于增进两国人民的了解和友谊，必将造福于两国和两国人民。
The situation of letting 100 flowers blossom and 100 schools of thought contend is on its way to be in place. While we make efforts in innovating contemporary culture and promoting the fine traditions of Chinese culture, we will also learn from and draw on the fine culture of all of the foreign countries, including that of the United States. Only when we adhere to the originality of our own culture and safeguard the diversity of human culture, adhere to opening up and tolerance, can there be cultural development and progress of human civilization. Looking back on history of China-U.S. cultural exchange on horizon of the 21st century, we will look ahead to bring a future with a positive and pragmatic attitude. There is an old Chinese saying that goes like this: everything thrives without interfering with each other. All Taos and ways of nature evolve without violations. The exchanges of different cultures make people pay more respect to each other through mutual understanding. make people become more innovative through learning from each other. Exchanges make culture more abundant and colorful. I believe the cultural cooperation between our two countries will reach a higher level with our conjunct efforts. It accords with the fundamental interests of the two countries, as well as two peoples, for the cultural institutions of both sides to strengthen exchanges and cooperations. It also contributes to the enhancement of the understanding and friendship between the two peoples, and eventually benefits the well-being of the people of our two countries. It is also conducive to the communication and harmony between Eastern and Western civilizations that will become a key driving force for the progress of human civilizations.
最后，向主办此次论坛的美国国家人文基金会和为论坛举办付出辛劳的加利福尼亚大学伯克利分校表示衷心的感谢。祝愿第二届中美文化论坛取得圆满成功！谢谢大家。Lastly,
I would like to express my sincere thanks to our co-presenter, the NEH, and as well as UC Berkeley for their excellent contributions, which the second U.S.-China Cultural Forum a great success. Thank you.